This video is on different sampling methods in statistics. And in Math 105, we're going to look at four sampling methods. If you're in 243, or if you take 243, we will do a few more. So if you need this worksheet, you can get it on my website at caraleemath.com. And these are the four different sampling methods we're going to look at. Simple random sample, systematic sample, stratified sample, and convenience sampling. So we have a question of interest or something we want to know about our population, but it's too time consuming or expensive or impossible to ask or measure everyone or every item in our population. So we get a sample, but how do we get that sample? So these are four different ways. And for each one, I'm going to draw a picture and write a description and give an example. So for example, let's say we want our population to be PCC students. We could even think of the same example that we used in the last video of the proportion of students who have been evicted. Okay, so a simple random sample is a very common type of sampling. And let's draw our whole population here. That means we randomly select people from our population. So simple random sample, subjects are chosen at random. And so the characteristic there is that every subject has an equal chance of being chosen. Every subject equally likely. Okay, so we're just going to, if you drew names out of a hat, that would be a random sample, simple random sample. It might be you'd need a pretty large hat to draw names out of a hat for PCC. So one example, one thing we could do is use G numbers. Everyone has a G number, and so we could use a computer program to randomly select a certain number of G numbers. So we could select a number of G numbers at random using a random number generator. Okay, so that's a simple random sample. We just grab a random sample of people. Okay, the next one is a systematic sample. There are some times when a systematic sample might be easier. Systematic means you pick either from a list or a line every nth person or subject. So you get an even spacing. Okay, so description for this one is make a list or a line, select every nth subject. Maybe you have a long row of tomato plants or corn plants. You might select every fifth plant to measure. Instead of measuring every single one, which would take a long time, you might measure every fifth or every tenth or every third row. You might have students in line for the cafeteria, or maybe in line for registration or something where there would be a long line, and then you could choose every fifth person, or maybe every tenth person who walks in the door, something like that. So that would be a systematic sample. So sometimes there's advantages when you have a list or a line, there's advantages to doing a systematic sample. So in our example of PCC students, we could write a few of those that I selected. So we could do it by G number. We could select every 50th G number. We can do that because they're in order, in numerical order, so that would work pretty well. Or we could choose every fifth student in line for something. Those are some examples of how to use systematic. Okay, the thing, we might not always want to use a simple random sample because we're drawing at random, we could get clustered, sort of a clustered sample. We could get a bunch of people, we could get more folks from Sylvania or more folks from Southeast. So another way to combat that, another type, is the stratified sample. Okay, this works really well when you have different subgroups in your population. So we have four campuses. We have Sylvania's pretty big, it's the biggest. Then I think Rock Creek. After that, Cascade is a little bigger than Southeast. So we have four different campuses. Instead of just sort of taking a chance with the simple random sample, we might not proportionally get each campus represented. And so this stratified is a way to divide into categories or strata and then select proportionally from each campus. So we could select a simple random sample just out of Sylvania, a simple random sample out of Rock Creek, a simple random sample out of Cascade, and a simple random sample out of Southeast. Okay, so the description for stratified is to divide into subgroups. This is not the only way to divide the PCC population. We could divide between on-campus and distance learning and hybrid, or daytime classes and evening classes. There are lots of different ways that we could stratify. Divide into subgroups, take a random sample, from each. Now it's interesting because we could pick the same number from each and have each group represented equally. For example, like the Senate has two senators from each state, or we could select proportionally from the population of each group, and that's more like the House of Representatives, where they have a number of representatives based on the population of the state. So you could do it either way depending on what you're studying. Okay, so in this particular case, we divided by campus and we sample randomly from each group or each campus sample randomly from each campus proportional to the population. Have to abbreviate population there. Okay, so those are three really good methods, and the method you use is going to depend on a lot of factors. What will best represent your population, and what type of situation you have, what is easiest to use, but still a good method. Now here's a method that's not good. So I'm going to put a frown. Put a frown on that one. I'm going to put smiles on these three. Okay. Convenience sampling is what it sounds like. You just do something that's easy for the researcher. I'm just going to ask five of my friends, or I ask my class, but I'm trying to get to know something about the whole PCC population. Or we just stand by the Great Hall and just get people who come by, but we might not get everyone. We might only certain people want to talk to us, or we might only think to talk to certain people. So that's a convenience sample. So this is choosing subjects that are convenient for the researcher. Probably not going to represent the population well. If we're doing something in the city of Portland and I just ask people on my street or the neighbors that I know, I'm probably not going to get a representative sample. Okay, so at PCC, an example would be asking people who walk by in the Great Hall at Southeast, or standing by the cafeteria. Notice I drew it that we're just sort of getting a group that's probably very similar in some ways and just not really spread out throughout the whole population. So that's a convenient sample. So we want to try to avoid that one and use the other three as much as possible. The reason is if you don't have a good sample, there's nothing you can do to correct that. You can't do anything with the math, anything with numbers to fix a bad sample. And that's also called a biased sample. So the last question here, what does it mean if a sample is biased? A biased sample does not represent the parameter, right? We're taking a sample to get a statistic, and if the sample does not, if the sample is biased and not representative of the population, our statistic will not estimate the parameter very well. Okay, so a sample is biased if it does not represent the population. In that case, the statistic that we calculate will not be a good estimate for the parameter. And the thing is, we won't have any way of knowing how far off it is. And so that's what I'm saying, there's no way to correct for it. So really, with a statistical study, the best thing is to put in the time and effort and energy up front in the beginning in getting a representative sample. Otherwise, you're gonna waste your money in doing this, the survey or whatever you're doing, and you won't have any results that you can really believe in and be confident in. So those are four common sampling methods and talking about a biased sample. So I'll see you in the next video.